This conference will now be recorded.
Hi everyone. In this session, I am going to discuss about Mule flows. In last session, I have discussed how we can develop a simple REST service. Today also, I am going to develop a simple REST service to explain about flow, subflow, private flow. These are types of the flows. And also, a subflow can be called synchronously. By default, it has synchronous nature. And also we can make it as asynchronous call. We will see that in similar way, private flow can be called in both ways. So coming to the Mule flows, arranging connectors to develop some logic that forms a flow. So let's see that. Let me create a simple project. Take it as a sample. Click on finish. Let me go to HTTP connector, drag and drop listener. Here, I can go for simple REST service development. I want to keep same HTTP and 8081 as port. Click on OK. Take path as sample. Save. Then we can have a start class. I can say flow start log. Okay. In similar, let me keep one more logger saying that flow end log. Save it. I'm calling this as a flow because a flow that contains event source. So if you see these dots, left side to these dots, we have event source. Event source nothing but which provides or allows you to trigger this logic. So if you have a HTTP listener here, you will be able to call this flow. So if you have a flow with event source, that is called as flow, or you can call it as a main flow also. So let me run this project and show you the execution. Meanwhile, let me form the request, HTTP, localhost, 8081, / sample. The project has deployed. Now let's make the request. Click on enter. Then we can see it has printed flow start log, flow end log. So a flow with event source is called as a flow or main flow. Next, what is subflow? In real time, if we are developing some logic, we usually keep connectors one by one here. Assume the development is taking to keep some 20 connectors here. If I keep 20 connectors side by side, side by side, side by side, this flow will become too linear. You have to scroll right, left to go through this flow. To avoid that, we can divide our main flow into several flows with the usage of a subflow. And also the main advantage with subflow is if you have some reusable logic, you should not write that logic again and again. Make it as a subflow, and wherever a main flow required or a subflow required that logic again, we can call from there. Let's see how we can develop a subflow first. To do that, we can do this in two ways. The first way is you can search for subflow, drag and drop here, and in this, whatever you want to develop, you can develop. So let me keep two loggers here to say that subflow start log. In similar way, let me take one more logger and make it as subflow end log. Then we are good to develop a subflow. And if you see the difference between main flow and subflow, the main flow has, our flow has event source, whereas subflow don't have event source. And if you see one more difference, here we have flexibility to do error handling. Don't worry about error handling. We will be discussing in coming session. For now, just have observation. And in subflow, we do not have error handling page. Now, if I would like to call this subflow from main flow, we use flowdefined. You see, we have flowdefined. Drag and drop. I'm calling in between start log and end log of a sample flow. Okay. So in drop down, we can see what are all the flows we have. Click on sample subflow. Save it. Now I develop a subflow and I would like to call this subflow from main flow. Now let's see the execution. If I click on save, it is automatically redeployed. So once you see started the app, that means it has deployed. Click on request. Now we can see first it printed flow start log. Next it printed subflow start log, then subflow end log, then flow end log, because I'm calling the subflow between start log and end log. Let me do one thing. Let me run this application in debugging mode. So the advantage of debugging is you can able to see the execution one by one connector. To do that, when you make a request, it should be the execution will come here. If you would like to stop in some point, just put the toggle breakpoint. Don't worry about debugging. In coming sessions, I am going to show you about debugging in brief. For now, I am just saying in high level. Okay, let's stop the server because I am running the project. Now I am going to debug the project. If I don't keep toggle breakpoint here, it will complete the execution and will go, so that we cannot able to see how it is executed. It will ask us to open in debugging mode. Click on S. Don't worry about the populated windows for now. In coming session, we will see the use of each and every window. It has deployed. Now click on. Now the execution will come here and it will be stopped. If you see some of the things are populating in the window, don't worry for now. We will discuss about debugging in brief. Now, either you can use Async or you can see next processor curved arrow here. Click on that and it will go one by one. Next, it will go to calling the sample flow, that is flow reference. Now click on next. See, it has came to subflow and it is printing the logger one by one. First it has printed flow start log, then subflow start log, then it will print subflow end log. Click on next. Now it has came to the end of the flow, then it will print the flow end log. So this way we develop a sub flows in real time. There are two reasons. Rather than making your flow too linear, it would be good practice to cut down into sub flows. And one of the most advantage is if you would like to have some reusable logic that can be called from multiple flows, then make it as sub flow rather than developing the same logic again and again. So that will increase the readability. So a new developer comes to the flow, it can easily understand it. Okay, that's about sub flow. Now to switch back to Mule design, if you see, we have two buttons here. This is debugging mode, it is activated now. Next, click on Mule design. You will switch back to the your design mode. Now, I would like to call this flow asynchronously. By default, this flow called as synchronously. Okay. By default, it will be called as synchronously. That synchronous means, so the runtime execution first come to here, then subflow has called, then it has executed this, then it has executed this. After completing the subflow only, it went to the main flow. By the way, before asynchronous call, I would like to tell you how we can pass our data to subflow. Okay, then how we can get back the data from subflow to main flow, right? Because we usually call subflow by passing some data, then we should get back whatever the subflow has processed the data back. So calling the subflow, we need not to do anything. Whatever you have in the payload before calling subflow, that will go to the subflow. Let me put that payload before the subflow. Here, let me write as flow hyphen payload. And in similar way, so while calling your subflow, whatever you keep in the set payload, that will go to the subflow. In similar way, in subflow, at the end of the subflow, whatever you have in the payload, that will go off response or return of the subflow. So before that, in the start log, let me print main flow payload. And in similar way, let me set payload in the end of the subflow. Let me put as subflow payload. Save. In similar way, here, let me print the payload. Because after calling subflow, the payload will be changed to subflow payload. Before calling subflow, I have payload as flow payload, because here whatever we keep in the payload, that will be returned by the subflow. It will automatically redeploy. Here, request came. Click on next. We are setting the payload. Now payload has a flow payload. Now it will go to subflow. If you see, it just printed the flow start log. Then in the subflow, in the start log, it will print the payload what it has received in the request. Now click on next. You see subflow start log. Flow payload. I am setting this payload before calling the subflow. That means we are able to pass input to a subflow. Click on next. Then I am setting the output payload. Click on next. So this logger will print end main flow with the subflow payload. Now you see I think I forgot to keep sub. Now flow end log, sub flow payload. That means whatever I am setting in the sub flow as a payload, that is coming as the response of the sub flow. So this way we develop sub flow. In similar way, how we can access variable across the flow. So in main flow, if you are creating a variable, you can access that variable in the subflow. In similar way, if you are creating a variable in subflow, even that you can use in your main flow after calling the subflow. Before calling the subflow, the variable won't be initialized. That is the reason you cannot able to get that variable. Let's see that now. So let me create a variable. Don't worry about as payload, as var dot a variable name for now. In next session, I discussed about MEL, a Mule expression language. There you can understand what is the MEL expression language and also how we can access variables, how we can access payloads, everything. Let me set a variable in the main flow saying that main var. Let me put it as main flow variable. Save. Now to access this main var, just in the end log, I would like to print subflow end log and main flow variable e. To access this, I can put as var dot the variable name. Click on save. In similar way, let me create a variable in the subflow as subflow var. Value as subflow variable. Save. And in the end log, along with the payload, here let me put subflow payload. And next, let me put subflow variable. I should write var dot subflow var. See, the data sense is able to show us the variables that are created. Save. Now, for suppose if I would like to use this variable before calling this subflow, it won't be available because we are initializing that variable in subflow. Let's say it will be automatically redeployed. Let me redeploy randomly. That's deployed. Let me make a request. Now it came here. Click on next. It will print the start log. So main flow, nothing but flow start log has printed. Now I am setting a variable. I am setting a variable payload. Then I am calling a subflow and see the payload already we see that has that went to a subflow. In similar way, we see the variable is going or not. Click on next. next. So here I printed the flow payload, and if you see, it has printed main flow variable because I set the variable value as main flow variable. You can see that here. I put as main flow variable this value as printed. In similar way, I have set a subflow variable here and payload here, that both will be printed in the end log of main flow. Click on next. Now we can see it has printed flow end log. A subflow payload is subflow payload I put. In similar way, subflow variable I put as subflow variable. You can see that value here. That means you just need to understand whatever the variables we create in the subflow, that can be accessed in the main flow after calling it. In similar way, whatever we create the variable before calling the subflow, those variables can be accessed in the subflow. So this way we can handle the payloads variables from flow to flow. Now, if you see by default, it is calling the flow synchronously. That means once the execution comes here, it is the execution going here and it is completely executing one by one, then coming back to here. Sometimes we may get logic implemented in such a way that we would like to call some flow asynchronously. Why we should call asynchronously means, suppose you don't have any dependency on this flow. Okay, that means you don't want the payload which will return back from the subflow, and also you don't want a variable which you initialize in the subflow. Just it go here and it should complete the execution and come it need not to come back. So just use and throw, like, you know, making asynchronous call. Asynchronous call in the sense, so the both will execute it parallelly. That will increase the performance. Multiple threads run in the runtime. So each thread will contain separate execution that will increase the performance. When you don't have any dependency that you are expecting something back from subflow, then go for synchronous. If you are not expecting something back, then go for asynchronous. To do that, just you need to use async scope. Just drag and drop async scope. And in this, just drag and drop the subflow which you would like to call. Now, if you see here, what will happen? It will execute until here synchronously. Then it will come here. One thread execution will go here, and main flow thread execution will continue here. That means it won't wait until this execution completes. So this is called as asynchronous flow. Calling a flow asynchronously. Synchronous means calling a flow sequential, means it will go here, it will execute one by one, then it will come back here. Asynchronous means calling a flow parallelly. It will go here and it won't wait for the execution of this flow should be completed. It will continue the main flow execution. I think it has deployed. Now let me make the request and you can see how the execution goes. So until set payload, it would be sequential call. You can see it is executing one by one. Now, once async calls goes, the call, one thread will be created against to the subflow and the existing thread will be continued on this. If you see, click on next. See, it didn't went inside, directly it is executing this. Click on next. Now you can see it went back. Back nothing but another thread execution is started separately. So it will complete the execution. Now you see how it printed. It printed flow start log, then flow end log. It's supposed to print what? It's supposed to print subflow start log and subflow end log as printed. So this way we make asynchronous call. So this is about a flow, a subflow, how we can call synchronously, how we can call asynchronously. Now let's see about private flow. Okay, so the private flow is one, same like a flow, but that doesn't contain the event source. That's it. the difference between the flow and the private flow is almost same except the event source. If you don't keep event source and if you keep this logic, this flow is called as private flow. Coming to the subflow, it never contains the source and also it won't contain the error handling feature. So to develop a private flow, you don't have any specific connector, but what you can do is you can drag and drop any connector in the canvas. Now you can see it has generated a flow. Let me rename it as sample private flow. It don't have event source. If it has event source, then it acts as a flow. But if it don't have event source, then it is called as private flow. Now you see it has error handling. So you can see that. So when you would like to have some error handling in the subflow, then you can go for private flow. When you don't want some error handling in the subflow, then you can go for the subflow. But in Mule 4, we got a good feature. We have a try block. So using try block, I can keep error handling in the subflow also. Just drag and drop here. Let me do one by one. So this way we can get the error handling for sample, subflows, but I do not want to confuse you now by discussing about this all features, but I just wanted to show you how we can do error handling in the subflow itself so that we need not to go for the private flows. Okay, let me revert it back. Just drag and drop outside and delete the try block. I just wanted to show you, that's why I just created it, but in error handling, I will be discussing all these. Now you can see the differences. We can have error handling features. Now let me keep it as private flow. Start now. Save. Now to call a private flow or subflow, it is same way. Now let me take as flow reference, and in the flow reference, I just need to call sample private flow. Click on save. So the way we are passing the payload or variable to the subflow, similar to private flow also. So I need not explain again. Click on save. Now you can see the execution. Next, 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 next. Because of asynchronous call, it is continuing the execution here itself. Then it will create one more thread. Now see, the execution came to private flow because we cannot predict it because the two threads are running now. Now you can see how it has executed main flow, nothing but flow start log, private flow start log, then subflow end log, flow end log, subflow start log. This way, we work with the flows, subflows and private flows. Even if you have one more main flow in your project, still you will be able to call that a main flow also. If you see in the flow reference, when I drag and drop flow reference, it is not showing me the subflows private flow. It is also showing the main flow. But remember, calling a main flow or flow from flow is not a good practice. The performance will be slowed down. than subflow. If you use subflows, the performance will be heavy. If you try to call a flow from flow, that shouldn't be a good practice. It always decreases your performance. So go for subflows. The main differences are, I wanted to repeat before wrapping up the session, a flow contains event source, is called as a flow. If a flow doesn't contain event source, but similar look like the subflow, is called as private flow. A subflow is one which doesn't contain the event source section. And one more difference, the flow and private flow can have error handling. The subflow couldn't have error handling. To get the error handling on the subflow, we can use try block and we can achieve there itself. So we can avoid the private flows. Or if you would like to have private flow, yes, up to you, you can go for it. So whatever the variable we create in flow, that can be accessed in subflow, in private flow, if you initialize those before calling a subflow. In similar way, whatever you initialize variable payload in the subflow, that can be accessed after calling the subflow. That's all about Mule flows. Thank you.